Hello everyone, I'm Svetlana Levitan. I'm developer advocate at Center for Open Source Data and AI Technologies at IBM. And today I will be telling you about open standards for machine learning model deployment. First, I will explain why model deployment presents challenges, and then we will talk about open standards that help to overcome those challenges. First of all, let's talk a little bit about how machine learning normally is done. As you probably know, first data needs to be obtained, collected, merged, cleaned, analyzed, transformed. Various feature engineering needs to be implemented. And you would probably build a few possible models and pick the best one based on your test data. But that's not the end of the story. Once you have a very good model, you want to put it into production. To be able to obtain predictions for new cases based on the model, and that is called model deployment. And again, that's not the end of it either, because once the model is deployed, it needs to be monitored for quality, and once there is some kind of model drift determined, then you need to collect new data and start the cycle all over again. So today our focus is this model deployment piece. And why is it often challenging? Models are normally built and deployed by different teams working with different programming environments, programming languages, file systems, etc. And so those who are developing the models are usually data scientists or statisticians, and those who need to deploy them into production, into either a database or maybe on a cloud somewhere, on a server, those are probably some people specializing in IT services, database administrators, etc. In addition to these differences, also there is this issue of data preparation steps. You cannot just deploy a model by itself. If it was built on some transformed data, then you need to apply the same data transformation steps to the new records before they can be scored by the model. And very often, once you get predictions from the model, you may need to do some post-processing as well. So you need to keep not just the model, but the whole data pipeline. And that sometimes presents difficulties. Well, this was pretty clear a long time ago. So in the 1990s, Professor Robert Grossman at the University of Illinois in Chicago developed organized the data mining group, a group of companies working together on developing open standards for machine learning model deployment. And first such standard was predictive model markup language, or PMML. It is a standard based on XML representation of models. And currently it is very popular. It has developed a lot in the more than 20 years of its history. And currently it is supported by over 30 vendors and open source organizations. And I've been fortunate to be working with this standard for a while and managing some latest releases. Now, what is PMML? How does a PMML document look like? As I said, it is an XML document. The root element would be PMML, and then inside it, there are required elements header and data dictionary, and optional elements transformation dictionary and one or more models. Header would just describe your application, copyright, etc. Data dictionary contains information about your data fields. We assume that the data is structured. Then transformation dictionary can contain those data transformations that we talked about, and the models have various model information. So a little more about transformations. What you would normally do with the data? You would probably normalize continuous fields. You could apply one-hot encoding to categorical fields. All those things are supported in PMML. And maybe if you have a continuous field, but you need a discrete field in your model, then binning can be described by discretize element, and there is map values element that describes your a mapping from some categorical fields to others. And there is a wide variety of functions, built-in functions and user-defined functions, and some other transformations. In terms of models, in PML 4.4, which is the latest release, released last year, we have 17 models listed here, plus we have mining model, which is provides a mechanism for creating model composition, model ensemble, or any combination of those. So this basically covers most of traditional machine learning pretty well. And inside each of PMML models, there are several standard elements. Mining schema is a required element. It tells us what is the target field and what are predictor fields, and also contains some other important information such as missing value replacements, outlier treatment, etc. Other elements are optional. Output can contain some post-processing steps that could be applied to model predictions. Model stats and model explanation describe various model information that is not really used for scoring, but is very useful for model visualization. So PMML is often used for model visualization as well. And then local transformations can have transformations inside the model, which is useful if you have several models in one PML. And model verification can help you make sure that your application correctly scores the model. Here, let's look at an example of a PML for this small neural network model shown here. I built this neural network model on Iris data, which I hope you all are familiar with. There is a set of data for 150 iris flowers, three kinds of flowers, four continuous dimensions. And here I am showing you data dictionary for this model. As you can see, data field with name class is the target variable. Well, you don't see that it's target, but it just says that it is categorical variable with these three categories. And then the four other variables are continuous variables. They are dimensions of the flowers. And then further, I'm showing a piece of transformation dictionary where for each new field you have a derived field element. And here we have a norm discrete example, which is part of one-hot encoding for the categorical field, and norm continuous, which provides this normalization of continuous fields. Further, here is a neural network element. This is the beginning of the actual model. And the first thing there is a mining schema, which says that class is a predicted field and other fields are predictors. By default, the fields are predictors. And then a neural input tells us how to connect the inputs of the neural network to the fields in our in our data. And in this part of the model, we can see a part of a hidden layer and output layer. So for each neuron in each of the layer of those layers, we have connections, elements con, coming from the elements in the previous layer, and the associated weights for them. As you know, weights are the most important part of the neural network. And you also can see here that it is a pretty verbose representation. So probably not very suitable for a deep learning model. But of course, in the 90s or early 2000s, nobody thought about deep learning. Here is another example, PMML. This one is for decision tree model, also built on the same Iris data. In this case, the data dictionary would be exactly the same as before. A transformation dictionary here is not needed. And the tree model itself has nodes, and each node describes a node in the tree. And children nodes are inside the parent node. And inside each node, there is a predicate, which is always true for the root node. And then here for node with ID 1, you can see that the predicate is that petal length is less or equal to 0.6, according to this picture. And for the other one, for the other child, it is greater or greater than 2.6. And then inside this second node, there are child nodes again. So you see, this shows you that PMML basically describes your model very well. And once you know the whole model, then you can figure out how to score it. And PMML is pretty widely used. And here is a list of probably incomplete or a little outdated list of all companies and open source organizations that supported PMML at some point. And now I want to show you how PMML is used, can be used with Python code. As you know, Python library, Skykit Learn is the most popular one for traditional machine learning. And so there is this package, family of packages, JPMML, which is created and maintained by Villu in Estonia. And that package includes the method sklearn to PMML that allows you to create, convert a PMML pipeline or sklearn pipeline into PMML using just a few steps. Basically, you just say, okay, sklearn to PMML, you give it a pipeline and you specify the name of the PMML file. And that's mostly it. Another library is called Nyoka, and this is created by different people. And it also provides conversion from Skykit Learn to PMML. It's kind of a competitor to, of the other library. I'm not exactly sure how they differ, but they both can be used. And there is a package, open source package PyPMML, which provides scoring for PMML models. So you can deploy your PMML model into this package. And it is actually a Python API for PML4S, which is, I believe, PML for Scala, which also can work with Spark. And here is a piece of code from PyPML library page that shows you how to use it. So you load the PML model using this method load, and then you call the method predict, and you get your predictions. R is, of course, another popular open source language, and there is a couple of packages in R for creating PMML. One is called PMML package, and it was created and maintained by people from Software AG who work with me in the data mining group. And another package is from JPML library called R2PMML that also helps to export PML for a number of models from R. And again, the use of it is very simple. You just call PMML on a model and you get your PML out. So PML is very good because it allows seamless deployment and model exchange. And it is, of course, human readable format. You could see that it was very easy to read. Which is good, and also machine readable. So it fosters best practices and provides collaboration. And if you have a model in PML, it's not a black box. You can see exactly what's inside, which is very valuable. Unfortunately, there is one problem with PMML. Well, maybe two. One problem was, okay, PML is great, but it describes your model. What if you have some kind of new model which is not yet described by PML? Then you are in trouble. You can use extensions. PML allows you to use extensions everywhere. However, if you use extensions, then you lose the portability, which is one of the main advantages of PML. And another problem is that it is using XML, and nowadays people prefer JSON format rather than XML. So about six or so years ago, Jim Pivarsky, who was working for Bob Grossman at the time, created this new format called Portable Format for Analytics, or PFA. It is designed with the experience of PML in mind. So it's kind of mini functional math language that that describes the scoring procedure rather than the model itself. And of course it is using JSON format, and it has many built-in functions and simple models that you can use as building blocks to implement your scoring algorithm. And it is described on DMG web page as well as PML. And here is a simple example of PFA, which my colleague Nick created. It shows you parts of the logistic regression model. As you can see here, it's really JSON, and I find it a little more difficult to read, but maybe I'm just not used to it very much. But it is describing how to score a logistic regression model. And what we know about open source support for PFA are those packages, Hadrian from Jim Pivarsky and his group, ArtFark, that's the library that was created by Nick, which exports PFA from SparkML, and Woken, which works mostly with Python, I think, Python and Scala, are created by Ludovic Claude in Switzerland. And definitely there are many opportunities for open source contributions for PFA libraries. Ludovic and Nick and myself had a poster at a conference in Switzerland last year in January, Applied Machine Learning Days. And for this poster, Ludovic created this nice diagram that I like, and so I copied it here into the slide. He is working for CHUV, it's some medical research organization, and they work with a network of hospitals in Europe who have a lot of data from their patients, but due to privacy considerations, they cannot exchange those models. So, they cannot exchange the data. So they build separate models in each hospital, and then they exchange. They combine those models together and validate and deploy them using PFA. And that's how he got involved with PFA. I think they could also use PMML if they wanted to, but well, they preferred PFA. Now, finally, let me talk about Onyx a little bit. So both PML and PFA did not develop quickly enough for deep learning. As you know, nowadays deep learning is very widely used, and there are so many different, well, at least a couple years ago, there was so many different deep learning frameworks, and it was very hard to exchange models between the different frameworks. The deployment of such models was always a problem. So Microsoft and Facebook created this standard, and then they open sourced it. It's called Open Neural Network Exchange. And that came out in September of 2017. It's using binary protobuf format. And then later some traditional ML coverage was added into Onyx as well. release 1.7 was just recently finalized. And I helped with that a little bit. And generally the core of Onyx is written in C++. And it also has Python APIs and various tools such as visualizer tools and others. And there is more than 20 GitHub repositories under Onyx. They contain various converters. There is a model zoo, there are tutorials, etc. And most major deep learning frameworks are supported by Onyx. Recently, in April, we had a meeting. So there are usually about three in-person meetings per year, where many people working on Onyx get together. In April, we had to have a virtual meeting, and Heidi Kim from Intel, who is one of the members of Onyx Steering Committee, showed this slide about how Onyx grew in about a year from the meeting in March of last year. You can see here that it is pretty actively being worked on, and the community is pretty large. More than 8,000 stars on GitHub. That's impressive. Here is a diagram showing support for Onyx from various organizations and companies and open source organizations. And you can see that's pretty impressive as well. And in terms of internal structure, the Onyx has a computational graph, which is the internal representation. And there are data types that are used in that graph. Operators and functions. The diagram on the right here is from one of the visualizer tools. It can show you what's inside the graph. So basically the graph should be acyclic, computational graph. And then for each operator, there are inputs, outputs, parameters, and names. Tensors with names, etc., and they all refer to each other by names. And in terms of data types, there are several different options for integers, floats, etc. And as you know, deep learning models can be very large, so it is very important to use the proper representation for all the weights in the proper size that helps to reduce the size of the model and also to accelerate scoring. And for in addition to tensors, there are also sequences and maps which are used for the traditional machine learning models. And Onyx is used pretty widely, in particular Microsoft open sourced Onyx runtime, which is a code that can run an Onyx model and get predictions for it. And they put a lot of effort into making it very, very optimized. So it is very efficient. And all Microsoft machine learning applications use Onyx inside, and that helps them to communicate easily. And I heard from many people that they're using deep learning model deployment with Onyx on edge devices. And I know that at IBM Research Group is working on converting Onyx into ML-IR representation that allows them to run it on different platforms, such as SystemZ, Power, etc. So in conclusion, model deployment is a very important part of the whole machine learning lifecycle, and sometimes overlooked part. And the data mining group works on PML and PFA, and PML is pretty widely used and is pretty good, except for deep learning. But for next release of PML, we are considering adding some support for deep learning. We'll see how it goes. And Onyx is the de facto standard for deep learning and also can be used for traditional machine learning. Although I think it may need some additions to be as deep as PML for traditional machine learning. And definitely there are many opportunities for open source contributions, especially for Onyx. And I invite you to look for those if you can contribute to open source. Finally, I just wanted to mention this Call for Code, a global initiative that invites developers to create applications to help people deal with natural disasters, with COVID and with climate change. And it is still running until end of July, so you still have time to join and contribute. There is a top prize of $200,000, so that may be a good stimulus for you. And if your project wins, then you also get support to actually implement it into practice. Finally, here are some links for you. And do let me know if you have any questions, and I'm always happy to discuss all those open standards. Thank you.